One of the things I wanted to find out was, can you tell me what the runways were like?
Runways. It was just a muddy pool. I suppose there was grass on it sometime, because there was little blades of grass coming through the water. But as far as we were concerned, it was just... it had been a field, and then it was flooded with the snow. And it looked, to me, it looked like an ill-kept pool of water. I do remember that we were sent round about a couple of times because they wanted us to land in certain parts of the drone. The other parts were just not acceptable, not possible to land the Hurricane in it. I went round a couple of times, and then I was out of petrol, so I'd got to land, and I just landed quite normally. A few sprays of water and mud. Don't forget, we'd flown up from Archangel, which is... Archangel to Murmansk is about 300 miles across the White Sea. And it was just about on our top limits. We'd had all our armaments stripped off, all guns, all ammunition. And we were just about making it. So to send us round more than twice was just stupidity. But we all managed to. I think we did lose one with the undercarriage, but otherwise we all landed quite happily.
I was going to say, regarding incidents, were there any incidents? But do you remember that one where the undercarriage went? Were you actually there at the time, or?
Sorry, I didn't get.
Were you there when that actually happened with the undercarriage, or was that while you were?
No, as we were landing, yeah. Yeah. But it was some manhandled off into the hangars, and there was plenty of labour, Russian labour. They just sort of manhandled it into the hangar and got it serviceable again in a very short time.
Were there any issues with the weather, like the cold for the aircraft? Were there any problems caused by the cold?
We had to be started up every half an hour, night and day, 24 hours a day. Else our engines just used to freeze solid and they would never start again. I felt sorry for the ground staff that were starting them up all through the night, giving them a run just to keep them from freezing up solid.
Were they British ground crew or were they Russian?
British, our own lads. Yes. It was quite a problem, but we managed to cope all right. A lot of antifreeze on the wings, all that sort of stuff.
Do you remember how those ground crew got to the base?
Yes. They came in, I can't remember the name of the ships, but they all came in various ships. A lot came in in the Landsteffen Castle with us. I don't know how many, but quite a large proportion of the 500 that went was in the Landsteffen Castle with us. And our aircraft was in the hold of the ship. And that's why I had to go into Archangel. To unload them, and then they would assemble there. And we had to fly them up from Archangel up to Murmansk, where the aerodrome was. That was about 300 miles.
So how did the ground crew get from Archangel?
Ah, well, they came on The rail link between Archangel and Murmansk had been bombed and strafed and whatnot, but they had to come on a train, and it was a pretty rough road, more or less having to repair the track as they went along it. But they all managed to get to Vianga, which was a drone.
Okay. Now, I've talked before about the missions that you did and the missions that you flew. A couple of questions I'm interested in. Did you ever fly any night missions?
No. We didn't have... We had no radar or anything like that. So flying at night was pretty impossible without any radar to direct us and whatnot. And we didn't have any landing lights anyway on the drone. There was no landing assistment, no lighting assistant on the drone. And the Hurricanes weren't equipped for night flying anyway. We didn't have the electronic equipment to help us to land at night. So we only did the daytime. But that kept us pretty busy. 109s were strafing us fairly often during the day. So every time they came over to strafe us, we had to get off the ground to retaliate against them. So we'd had enough without night flying. I did do night flying in England, of course, on Defiance, which was a terrible aircraft. All pilots hated Defiance. They were death traps. And that's another little story, though. Do you want me to tell you about that? Well, I think I've told you that I really liked my training to become a pilot, and I did extra to what I was supposed to do. And for that, they stamped my logbook above average. It was a stupid thing to do. Never do that in the forces. Anyway, I was posted to Churchill Squadron, which was 615 Squadron. Which is a Battle of Britain squadron, of course, stationed down the south of England. And I was posted to them. And then I can't vouch for this, but there was strong rumours that the Germans had got 9,000 troops waiting to land in Ireland. And they were going to come over into Anglesey, take over the valley, the airfield, which was a major airfield at that time. And of course that would have neutralised Liverpool and all the shipping there, of course. And so 615 were down the south of England. And we were all posted up to Valley in North Wales, defence of Liverpool, and the convoys going from Liverpool down to South Wales. In those days, it was so bad, we were so short of pilots. There was a squadron of Defiance on Valley, on the same airfield, just a little further around the perimeter. And things were so bad, I would fly Hurricanes in the daytime with 615, and then I'd be loaned to 456 Squadron, Defiance Squadron, if they were flying at night. And I'd be flying Defiance at night over Liverpool and Manchester and North Wales. Anywhere else they'd have me.
So when did you sleep?
Sorry?
When did you sleep?
Oh, that wasn't every night. We managed to get some sleep in. Not every night, but we managed to get a bit. We did all right on that anyway.
Well, what was the worst thing, or why was the Defiant so hated?
Oh, well, it didn't have any good points. It was grossly underpowered. The gun turret in the back weighed a ton in its own, just the gun turret and the ammunition. The Defiance had the same engine in as a Spitfire, and it was a ton heavier to start with. It had no maneuverability. It was slow. It would hardly get off the ground. The stalling speed was about over the 100 mile an hour mark. And it really was a death trap. I do remember I was flying with 615, and the CO said, "Oh, you've got to go to Newcastle to a special testing area on your eyesight." Well, my pal and I knew what that was. It meant that they were going to put you on night flying, and we hated night flying. We didn't want to go on that. So we went over to, I can't think of the drone now, for this night flying test. And we were determined to make a mess of it. We were putting down battleships for aircraft. You had to sit in a darkened room for about 8 hours, pitch black. And then they'd put silhouettes on the screen. You could hardly see them, and you had to say what these were, what aircraft they were. Well, we'd put down battleships for aircraft and silly answers. And when my pal was on the way home, he said, "Well, that should fix it. They'll never pass us on that." 3 or 4 days later, when we were in 615 flying, CO sent for us. He said, "Well, lads, you've passed, and you're posted on to 456 night flying." We were so disappointed. But luckily, or unluckily, a few months later, I was posted to Russia.
So, going back to Russia then, when you were on the base, you obviously had Hurricanes there. Do you remember any of the other aircraft that were on the base? Were there any other aircraft other than Hurricanes?
In Murmansk?
Yes.
Oh yes, there were several Russian squadrons, although the Russians didn't have many aircraft. The Germans were advancing 200 miles a day into Russia, and they smashed almost the Russian Air Force. So the Russians didn't have a lot of aircraft, but there were two or three squadrons on the same drone as we were. They were pretty ancient looking things, but I suppose that's why the Russians liked our Hurricanes, step up for them.
I know during the early war that the Russians had P-40s as well, but it doesn't necessarily mean they were there. I just wondered if you remember do you remember any of the aircraft type they had? Because I know the I-16s or the Yaks, the Lags.
There were Yaks there, I know that, but I don't know the others. I don't know. I've no idea what the other aircraft were.
You were only interested in your Hurricane.
That's right. They were fighter aircraft of a sort.
Yeah.
And they had, of course, they had bomber types. I don't know what they were. But one of our main jobs was escorting the Russian bombers when they were bombing the German lines, which were not very far away from us. The Germans were about 10 miles away. And of course they were bringing up war material. And I have seen the memos which were sent to the German command there. The German command there asked for a few tanks to advance onto us and just annihilate us. And luckily for us, the Hitler said he couldn't afford to send tanks there. He wanted them all on the Eastern Front. But they were quite close to us, and with a little bit of effort, they could have easily overrun the aerodrome.
So, during the missions that you flew escort, were most of them low-level missions?
Yeah. Yes, they were. I don't think these bombers were capable of getting too high, but we were bombing at about 10,000 feet, which is low level for bombing operations. And we were bombing their drones and their supply lines. I did 40 escorts of bombers, and we never lost a Russian bomber, which we were very proud of, because before our squadron was escorting them, they were losing quite a lot of bombers. So that we did a good job there to start with.
During your missions when you were flying in Russia, did you ever do any strafing missions or ground attack missions?
No. We did escorting the bombers, dogfighting with 109s. I'm trying to think of another one that used to come over to take photographs. Storch or something.
Oh, yeah, Storch, yeah.
That was our mission, and to teach the Russians to fly. The three things. Which we put up a pretty good show. We shot quite a lot down, and we weren't allowed to claim a kill if the Russian ground forces had fired at you. If the Russian ground crew had fired anything at the German aircraft, we couldn't claim it. Even if they'd been miles away, we weren't allowed to claim it.
So when you were over there, did you know how long your mission was due to last?
Good question. I don't think Churchill ever thought we would be coming back. We got there okay, which was a miracle considering the number of submarines that were patrolling, German submarines that were patrolling that area. And then after we'd taught the Russians to fly, Stalin actually didn't want us there because he didn't want his own people to know that he'd had to ask the West for any help. So our government said, wanted us to go across, right across into the eastern front of Russia to help there. But Stalin said, I'm not having you going west to east with your transport when all my supplies are going north, south to north, and he wouldn't let us go. So we were very pleased about that. And then months later, well, yes, months later, it was more or less get back how you, the best you can. And I got back onto HMS Kenya, which is a big cruiser. When I say cruiser, in naval terms, it's a great big destroyer thing, 6-inch guns on it and that sort of thing. So quite a few of us came back on that. A few dozen, not all that many, but they come back on various ships that they could get on. So that's how we got back.
And when you got back to Britain, do you remember where you docked?
Sorry?
Do you remember where you docked in Britain when you came back?
Yeah, Edinburgh.
Okay. So when you get back to Edinburgh, where do you go from there?
Went to Newcastle, where I changed to Spitfires, from Hurricanes to Spitfires.
How long did you have to make that transition?
Not many weeks, 3 or 4 weeks, that's all.
And when, because I have no idea on this, when you do the transition from Hurricane to Spitfire, is there a lot of sitting in the cockpit on the ground with somebody who knows how to fly Spitfires telling you what happens?
No. The night before, they give you the logbook, the instruction book. It's a big thick, yeah, it's a fairly thick book. And I say, yeah, I'll read that. You're flying in the morning, and that's what you had to do. You'd read the instructions, what it did. Mind you, that's not so difficult really, because the Hurricane got the same engine, so you know what you were dealing with. The thing was to read the book, tell you what you could do and what you couldn't do, because you're not supposed to bunt a Spitfire. By that I mean, well, if you're doing a loop, you're not allowed to do it with where you are on the outside of the loop, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
That's called bunting it. And the wings are not built for bunting. They're built for, you can loop it, of course. That's part of the everyday job. But that's when the wings are taking the stress in that particular way. They're not meant to take the stress when you're bunting the thing. So that was forbidden. And you learned various little tricks to, if you've got somebody on your tail, side slipping and fishtailing it and that sort of thing, which probably saved your life.
Well, did you remember which version of the Spitfire that was? Was it the Mark One? Did you have cannons on it, or did you have the machine guns? Do you remember if you had cannons, or did you have machine guns?
We had 8 machine guns.
Okay.
We could, yes. They were, we could have had, if the CO wanted it, could have had 8 cannons. But you only use cannon if you're going to shoot up railway engines or something like that. Machine guns were much better for what we were doing. Covered a bigger area. And there was no need. What do you want a cannon for? To kill somebody? Yeah. The Spitfires that we were flying. And they were all hydraulic.
And what did you think of the Spit 5?
It was very good, very good. That doesn't just mean to say I didn't like the... The Hurricane was excellent aircraft as well. It was a nice aircraft, very forgiving. It didn't have to be... so precise when you were flying it. It had a big wide undercarriage so you could bounce it into landing. If you stalled it, you could get it out of the stall pretty quickly. Spitfire. If a Spitfire went into a spit, into a spin, you were going to lose 2,000 or 3,000 feet before you could get it out of the spin. Which is, if you're near the ground, that's a lot. So,
so don't get it into the spin.
Yeah.
Do you remember what it was like on the stall characteristic in comparison to a hurricane? What it was like on the stalls?
Well, the Spitfire stall is about 90-odd. Yeah, just under 90. It started to shudder. You knew it was going. But then if you didn't do something about it, it would flip over, drop a wing and flip over. A hell of a race. And before you knew it, we were in a spin coming down. Now it was up to you to get that out of there and know what you're doing. Now with the hurricane, it wasn't, it would spin okay, but it was a bit leisurely and you could take your time doing it. Fighting a 109, I would rather have the Spitfire because it was faster. But the Hurricane, well, we shut a lot down with Hurricanes, so they must have been all right.
Well, they were talking about the early Hurricanes. One of the problems they had was fuel injection, or lack of it. So what the 109s would do, if they were being chased, is they would dive down, because they had an injection engine.
Yes, that's right, yeah. Carburetor they had. That's right. And the Spitfire. It was carburetor fed. It was one of the faults. If you went to, if you turned yourself onto, you know, upside down or for any reason, it would cut out. And it would be, now that didn't matter particularly, normally. But if you were got a 109 up your rear, it was very worrying. That was one of the faults with the Spitfire, because the 109 had a fuel injection. They didn't cut out on there. That was one of the faults with the Spitfire. One of the few, there weren't many faults with it, but that was one of them.
What was the visibility like for a pilot? What was the visibility like compared to a hurricane for the pilot? You know, what was the view like?
It was just as good. It was as good, if not better, than the Hurricane. The only fault with the Spitfire was when you were landing, you had to come in at an angle, in a big curve, because the only way you could see in front was between the cowling, the engine cowling, and the wing. If you were coming in onto the runway, you always come in on a big curve, because you'd got a 16-foot engine in front of you. Couldn't see anything straight ahead.
One of the things I can ask you about that, because when you taxied out to take off.
Mm.
Obviously, you've got the same issue in that the fact that your tail's down, the nose is up, very little visibility. Now, I've seen aircraft weaving on the runway.
That's right.
Do you remember ever having any? I've seen American footage where they'll actually have like a crew chief sat on a wing as they taxi out.
Yeah.
Did you ever have any? Do you remember any time when you had a member of the crew sat on your wings?
Oh, yeah. In Russia, we had to have two on. That was one of the troubles. We had to have two ground staff sitting on the wing, on the tail. That was because of the condition of the airfield. But that was caused called us to lose one pilot. We were being strafed, and the thing was to get off the ground as quick as you could. Now, if you were taxiing a Hurricane in those conditions, you had to have two ground staff sitting on the tail. Otherwise, you'd take the end off your propeller. And because we were being strafed, this chap, the drill was to do all your drill with the chaps on the tail, and then when you were ready to take off at that minute, you told them to get off, shut your engine down, so they could jump off and get away, and then take off. But because we were being strafed, this pilot, it was understandable, wanted to get off the ground as quickly as possible. He took off and forgot the chaps on the tail, got up to about 200 or 300 feet, and he stalled, came down, crashed, killed the two on the tail, and injured the pilot badly. He never flew again, and he was sent back to England. So, yes, we used to have somebody on the tail.
Okay. I've got to talk to you about the Liverpool story, because I've told you I love the Liverpool story that you told me, okay? What I could really do with Eric, can you tell me in as much detail as you can what time of day it was, if you remember what the weather was, just everything about that mission where you had your Hurricane shot up, well, flagged up.
Well, it was a normal procedure. When they delivered a new plane from the factory, Joy Loftus used to do that from the factory to the squadron, and then the CO would say, take that up, do what it says it's supposed to do from the factory, you know, in manoeuvrability and performance and all the rest of it, and see as it's all right. So I took this brand new Hurricane up, went through two or three layers of cloud. I must have been up at about 20,000 feet, more. And then I saw these little puffs of white smoke coming around me. I'd never seen these before. I thought it was some weather conditions. And I was enjoying it. They looked very pretty. And then suddenly I was called to base immediately. So, of course, I went back to base, Valley in North Wales. And when I landed, the CO sent for me and said, have you been over Liverpool? And I said, no, that's all I know of. I've been through cloud. I thought, I had no idea. He said, well, somebody has, and they've been firing at it from the ground. And when they looked, my rudder and elevators had got all shrapnel marks through them. So they must have been pretty close. So he wasn't very pleased about it, but it wasn't my fault. They should tell me where I was.
Can you, if you remember, do you remember how the startup procedure for a Hurricane? Do you remember the startup procedure?
Yeah.
Could you tell me the startup procedure in a Hurricane?
Oh, God, that's a test on my memory, that is. No, I couldn't tell you the startup. You had the trolley hack, of course, plugged in. You ran you always tested your controls, see if they're all working up to where they should be, all your flaps, etc. You checked that you were in, that was a little lever on the left-hand side, checked that it was in rich mixture, always check that your propeller was in fine pitch. That's like you use in bottom gear in a car. See that it was in fine pitch. You always tested your radio. There was 5 channels in those days. 1 to talk to the base, 1 to talk to nationally if you were in difficulty or anything like that, 1 emergency, and 1 it used to be it was a certain frequency, I forget what it was. But I know the WAFs used to say, it used to be on when you took off. No, it didn't. It wasn't on when you took off. But as soon as you got airborne, you had to put that on. And that identified you being German or British. And I do the rude remarks I've heard on that one. The WAFs, they were checking on the ground, of course. You'd say, is your cockerel crowing? I don't know what they'd be saying nowadays to that, but there was quite a few rude remarks about it because you'd forgot to switch it on. That's what they were annoyed about, telling you you're liable to get shot down if you don't put your cockerel on. That's about it. I can't remember anything else. So you were airborne anyway.
Yeah, I was going to say, so but to actually start the engine up.
You tested your mags, of course. You got your 2 mags. You used to knock 1 mag off and see what the drop was. And then put that on and drop the other one off. And they weren't allowed to be dropping more than 10% on either side.
What did the mags do?
Mags is...
I know the magnetos, but what did they actually do? I don't know what they did.
Well, the magnetos were doing the same function as sparking plugs do now. They created the spark plug, the ignition for the engine. And you always had 2 in case of, on all aircraft, there's 2 in case 1 cuts out. And you had to test those before you took off, always, to see that they were firing up to as good as they should be.
How was the engine started after that?
Oh, well, you got a starter button. And you shouted down to the chap on the ACT trolley. He'd plugged it in and got away from the propeller and pressed the starter button. And because you got your accumulator plugged in, that would fire then. It's fire. That was it. It just used to fire away then.
Okay, so your engine's running. Can you tell me what the procedure is now from the point where you started your engine to the point where you leave the runway? Can you tell me what you have to do to get to that point?
Yes, you just opened your throttle up. Full throttle, of course. You waited until you were getting somewhere over the 90 mile an hour. Your tail would be up, you'd feel your tail come up. You'd see your speed up to 90, and then it'd be starting to lift. You could sense it starting to lift. Then you pull your control column back, and you'd feel it just take off. There was nothing you could do then until you were up to about 500 feet. then you'd throttle back a bit. You didn't want to be on full throttle all the time. Throttle back a bit. Get out of the circuit because of your hindrance to the other aircraft trying to land. And just get up to your height they wanted you to get up to.
What sort of, how long after you took off did you raise your undercarriage up?
Some clever dicks used to try and get that up before they got the end of the runway. It wasn't a good idea. I would always get up to about 500 feet before I put the undercarriage up, because an aircraft will sink about 6 foot when you put your undercart up. You know, the lift that the undercarriage gives you and all the trappings on it. That's why it's like, if you've got flaps on, never ever put your flaps up if you're near to the ground, because you'll drop. You'll drop about 30 feet. And if you go and say near the ground at, I don't know, 100, 120 mile an hour, something like that, and you decide you've taken off with your flaps down, or partial flap, to give you more lift. And then you decide you want your flaps up to get your maximum lift and all the rest of it, maximum speed. Never ever put your flaps up, because you'll drop about 30 feet like a stone. And if you're pretty near to the ground, it's not very healthy.
So when you took off, were the flaps always up?
Yes. I say yes. Normally, yes. In special circumstances, you might want to take off with part flap to give you more lift to get you off for some reason. That's okay, but you should not keep flying with your flaps down, because you're struggling against your engine, really. I mean, that's trying to get you forward. Your flaps are down to put the brake on. Although it gives you a lot more lift with your flaps down, obviously.
Well, I'm going to get back to that hurricane over Liverpool. Having flown a hurricane and then being asked to fly a new hurricane, were there any particular things you were looking out for on a new hurricane that you were testing? Or were there any things you were wary of or more concerned about?
No, I can't think so. You couldn't have any instruction, obviously. All you got was your manual, your flying manual. You used to give it you the night before and say, yeah, I'll read that through. And if you got any sense, you'd read it through and read it through again.
When you buy a new car,
yeah,
there's always a new car smell. Did new hurricanes smell different to old war-weary hurricanes?
I don't think so. It used to smell of glycol and petrol. Actually, I didn't like it. It was a horrible smell. But, you know, it was a smell you could sort of get addicted to. Burning glycol and burning petrol fumes. I suppose it had a morbid sense of power.
One other thing, when you took off, Did you taxi with the canopy open?
Yes.
And close it at the end of the runway?
Yes.
So you always took off with the canopy closed?
Always. Well, I did. Yes, because if you took off and got up to, you sort of got up to 200 mile an hour, it's difficult to shoot your canopy then. It's quite difficult. Yes, you wanted that shot before you started any high speed manoeuvres.
Did you ever have any incidents that you thought you might have to bail out?
The only time, not because of any of my action, but the only time I ever thought of it was in the Defiant at night. Pitch black, if you can imagine that. Pitch black. You had a gunner in the back. Gotta think of him as well. You've got the Welsh Mountains on one side. You've got over all the occupied areas like Liverpool and Manchester. You said balloons on a piece of wire. And if you ran into those balloons, it'd cut your wing off as clean as a whistle, just like cutting through butter. So it was bloody dangerous. You'd got your, if you were a little bit out in your calculations, you'd be over Liverpool with the balloons. You've got your fuel to keep an eye on. You've probably got the ground staff telling you to go. Bandits, 10,000 feet, 2 o'clock. You've got all that to work out and see to. And you got the mountains, if you're a fraction out, you've got Snowdon, and that's about 3,000 feet. I'm bloody lucky, that's all I know.
But there was never any incident where you had like an engine fail, or you were in a situation where you thought, oh, I might have to take to my parachute?
Yes. Well, if there was a raid over Liverpool, we'd be sent off. And then you'd come to the end of your fuel capacity. And you'd come back to base area, and ask for landing. And if there was a raid on, they wouldn't put the lights on, you know, on the runway. And they'd say, you'd say, request light for lights for landing. They say, no, raid's still on. Call back in 5 minutes, you see, or something. Well, you'd be out of petrol, boy, nearly. And then you come back in 5 minutes and ask again. They'd say, no, raid's still on. And then the next time you'd come back with a mayday call. Say, I'm out of petrol, I must land. Sorry, go out into the RDC and bail out. Bloody stupid. Luckily, on the last gasp, I'd stick the lights on and you'd see aircraft coming in from every angle, trying to get in there. That was time when we were working out the possibilities of bailing out. Had no alternative.
Okay, this will be hopefully the last question there, Eric. And it's still about Liverpool and that hurricane. Can you tell me, from what you remember, what was the weather like and roughly what time was it that you took off? when you took off in that hurricane that got hit by the flak. Can you just tell me roughly what time it was and what the weather was like?
It was in the morning, 10 o'clock-ish in the morning. And the weather was quite good. I was quite enjoying it. It was all over Anglesey and Liverpool, Manchester. And I was up to the very limits. The poor old hurricane was standing up on his stomach. You do realise that you lose lift as you go higher. I forget the figures now, but it's a certain percentage for every 1,000 feet you lose on your speed. So your speed, how can I explain this? If you're up at 25,000 feet, then your speed has been reduced. Your lift, rather, it was about 1.5% or something. Whatever you're trying to do, 200 mile an hour, your speed has come down till it's stalling speed, nearly. You can't go any further than that. If you do, you'll just drop out of the sky. But I must have been up at about 23,000 feet. A bit of flap on. Trying everything. Did all the aerobatics you're supposed to do.
When you say supposed to, what sort of things did you have to do with the aircraft to test it?
Oh, you got to do rolls and spins. Corkscrews, you know. Try all your elevator controls and your rudder controls. See if it stalled at the speed they said it should do. That was important. Because, you know, for landing, you've got to know pretty accurately what your stall's at when you're coming in. So you've got to check all that. Check all your controls. See if it worked okay in fine pitch, in rough pitch and all the rest of it. Now we're coming into land with coarse pitch. Like coming, what can I say? It's like trying to go up a steep hill in top gear because your engine will just cut out on you. So you get into a fine pitch, judge what you think is a fine pitch. You just checked everything. See if your revs were right for the position of your throttle. I was thinking, I don't think we had to check guns on that exercise. We did on some over Morpeth. We always had to try our guns. We took off, give it a burst, see if they were all working all right. No, I think I can't remember anything else.
Okay. And the last question about the flak. Did you actually hear any of the flak?
No, you couldn't hear anything. No, it was just like a wide tennis, bigger than a tennis ball, of course. It was like a big white blob, probably 30 foot across, white cloud. And it was happening instantaneously all over the, you know, all round. I didn't know what it was. I'm bloody lucky, I know that.
I know I said the last one, but the one more question I wanted to ask you about Burma. Now, you went to Burma, and one of the things that you said last time, which I found quite interesting, Because we were talking about the Spitfires that had got buried, and you said you remember an aircraft going off the end of the runway and not being there the next morning.
Yeah.
Can you just tell me about that again, and what you remember?
It wasn't a hurricane, it wasn't a Spitfire that was sunk, it was a Hudson bomber. It was American-made Hudson. It wasn't as big as a Lancer, about half that size, but it was quite a big bomber. And it got a bit of engine trouble, nothing much, but it landed and they couldn't fix it. So they got it to the end of the runway, thought it'd be all right. Next one, it had gone, sunk in the ground. It was all bug-like. It's bloody awful.
Where was that?
That was at just outside Rangoon. I can't remember the names now. But it was just outside Rangoon anyway.
That's where you were based?
Yeah.
Who were you with then? Who were you flying for or with?
Well, it was still 81 Squadron. But there wasn't a lot of flying. Well, I didn't do much flying. I was very, very ill. I'd got dysentery and I'd had malaria. So I didn't do a lot. And we'd shot all, there was no very few Japanese aircraft about. We'd shot them all down. I don't know why, but I can't remember a great deal. Well, I do know why. I was so ill. I was very, very ill. I lived on tins of... Our rations used to come up in a tin can about a foot square and about 2 foot deep. And the rations would be for a month in there or whatever it was. And in there was a tin of fruit, always. And I lived on the juice from the fruit, tin of fruit, for I don't know, a long time. I was down to, like, you see the prisoners on the television. I don't know, it was weeks anyway. But I was in no condition to fly anyway. And then I did start flying. I was flying Dakotas. I was flying Dakotas from Rangoon. The war had stopped, Rangoon was in a terrible state. There was nothing there at all. They were starting to get civilised. The Navy had put a submarine in the bay of Rangoon, and a cable from the submarine, I don't know how they connected it up at Rangoon, but they did. And they could supply electricity to Rangoon. Not much, but enough to lights, you know, few lights and whatnot. I was flying, I wasn't supposed to, but I was flying Dakotas, a supernumerary crew. And we used to fly from Rangoon up to Calcutta. And of course, Calcutta, you could get anything. That was over the hump, what they called the hump, which was one of the Alps, I suppose, whatever it was. And a Dakota could just get over the top if you didn't have too much load on, what they call getting over the hump, into Calcutta. There the ladies in Rangoon loved Calcutta talcum powder because they had no cosmetics or anything, but they used to use Calcutta talcum powder to powder the faces. And you could get quite a good price for that. So we'd fill our kit bag up with Cuticura talcum powder. And then We'd fly from Calcutta to Bangkok. In Bangkok was noted for silk. You could load up with silk there and bring that into Rangoon. Of course, you could double your price for it in Rangoon, sell your load in, not a load, but a fair amount, and get a good profit. And they were happy in Rangoon. The girls were happy. And then in Rangoon, they used to get rubies and sapphires out the river. They used to come down in the river. And the locals had, all the local Burmese had a bag of sapphires and rubies. And you could buy them off them, take them up to Rangoon, get a good price in Rangoon for them, fill them up with cuticulas, that's it, fly that into Bangkok, buy your silks in Bangkok, back into Rangoon. On every stage, we weren't allowed to send home more money than you'd drawn. Well, of course, we'd never drawn any money from our pay. We used to get paid every month if you want. I'd never drawn any money for months and months. And they got all this money. So I went to Calcutta, and they made, oh, to Delhi, and they make beautiful carpets there. And I sent carpets to cover all my rooms in my house in England. They came through all right. They were honest. And they must have done 30 years. They were beautiful things, about 2 inches thick. We were allowed to send them. Can't think why, but we did. And they came through all right. And that's how we got rid of our money.
So when you were over there, how long, or when did you find out, did the war in Europe finish while you were there, or did World War II finish while you were there?
War finished while we were there, because we heard it on, we had a little radio, and we heard all the things going on in England. And I was up to my waist in mud and horrible things. And all we'd got between about 5 of us was a bottle of whiskey. So we had a bottle of whiskey between us. We were very, very upset. But we got a soldier on, and all them in Europe had got, they weren't released, but there was no fighting going on. And then I didn't come home until, I don't know, 5 or 6 months later, before when he came home.
So the war in Europe finished in 1945, obviously. But then World War II was over in just after August. I think it was August the 15th when Japan surrendered. So that meant it was all over. When you heard war in Europe was over, you had a bottle of whiskey, but then... What about when World War II finally finished with the Japanese surrender? Do you remember that, when that happened?
There were no celebrations then. Everybody in England has forgotten all about the war. And we've certainly got nothing in Burma. We got nothing. So all we want to know is when... This is why Churchill lost the election in 1946. Lady Astor was a Conservative MP, and she said we'd got to wear a yellow... if we came home, we'd got to wear a yellow armband because we'd been in a VD area. God, we nearly bloody exploded. It was beyond belief, because we used to have a little newspaper called SEAC or something, Southeast Asia Command, that's right, sick. It was in the paper that Lady Astor had said that we weren't allowed to go home unless we wore a yellow armband. We thought, God, blimey. And then, what was another thing? Churchill said we couldn't come home unless we got a job to come to in England. Isn't he stupid? How could you get a job out there? Anyway, I was lucky again, because Dad was part of an estate agent. He was a estate agent. And they wanted an electrician to wire all their houses. So he applied for me to be an electrician, and I managed to find a job doing that. That's all I get. But it was rough to the end, Burma was.
I mean, you say you were ill during the time in Burma, but when you got there, what was the airfield like? What were the conditions like when you actually arrived there?
I went into Imphal, which is right up by Calcutta, not far off India. The Japs had got to within a few hundred miles of India, you see. And there was a big battle at Imphal, the turning point of the war. That's where I went into. It was so bad that the main road in Calcutta is called Chowringhee. And that's like Park Avenue in London. Beautiful long strip. And they closed out and there was flying hurricanes off there to fight the Japs. Anyway, I went all the way down Burma, Mandalay, Cox's Bazaar, Akiab. Oh, I can't think of the names now. Right down to Rangoon I went, all the way down, about 1,000 miles. And we didn't take Burma. There was no such thing as taking Burma. It was thick, thick jungle. You couldn't walk a yard into the jungle. We used to clear six foot each side of the... They used to make a bit of a track down in the jungle, and then they'd clear 6 foot either side of any Japs in the undergrowth. Then we'd move on. There's nothing else you could do. And by the time you'd moved on a few days, it had grown up behind you, the jungle had. So it was rough. Of course, it was sort of, we liked it when the Gurkhas were with us. You could have a rest then. Otherwise, you just slept on the floor. There was no kit. The only kit you got was what you could carry. And next morning, there'd be white ants all around you. And you used to have a piece of canvas to sleep on, like a bathing towel. And next morning, they'd eat the bloody towel, all except the shape of your body. And it was awful.
It sounds incredible. I mean, when you were over there, did you, apart from flying Dakotas, did you fly any other aircraft?
No. Yes. Apart from Dakotas, I didn't fly anything else.
Okay. And even though you were flying Dakotas and though you were on the ground, did you see, in your time there, did you see any Japanese aircraft at all?
Yes, I saw two or three fighter aircraft, but they were shot. We'd got far superior air force there. Well, they got nothing. We hadn't got a lot, but they got even less. They were shot down pretty quickly after they arrived, sort of thing.
This is like when by your base.
That's right, yeah. Yeah. My memory is pretty good for my age, I think. That's 70 years since I was there.
That's right, yeah, I agree. When you came back to Britain, well, two parts. How did you get back to Britain? And then once you were back in Britain, I don't say how were you treated, but were you... Did people recognise what you'd done, but did people speak to you about it at all? So how did you get back first?
I came back on the Llansteffen Castle. No. Orontes. Orontes it was. Came back on from Rangoon into... And the bloody cheek! We had to be tested in England for VD and all that before they let us loose. We were straight off the ship into, it was near Blackpool, I can't think of the name of this place. I don't know what it was called. Reception area anyway, reception zone. Right by Blackpool. I remember going into Blackpool, and I went to a restaurant. I was absolutely amazed how well they were doing. And I ordered bacon and egg, I think. It was beyond my belief. And the bloke on the table was complaining because it was Erzeug egg. You know, it's like egg powder. He was complaining and he got his egg and his bacon. I thought, you miserable sod, if you'd have been living where we were, you'd think it was marvellous. And I would demote from there. That was it.
That's it. And people didn't really talk to you about, you know, your experiences, or it was just you're just another member of the services?
Well, not a good question, that, because we weren't liked when we come back here. I found a lot of animosity towards us, to servicemen. Firstly, anybody on two legs during the war and a bit of brain could get a good job, a managed job, because there was no men. You know, they were being pushed up and up. Well, when we come, we wanted our jobs back. And of course, we were a threat to their jobs. And so, naturally, they didn't like us at all. In fact, the first job I went for, you know, in the first few weeks, the manager said, "We don't want you here, you scroungers," or something. I just didn't hit him. You know, because he got some opposition, you see. They don't tell you that. It sticks in my mind. Funnily enough, while I was waiting to be called up, I had a job at the Austin Shadow Factory in Longbridge. I had it for a few months. And there was a law came in that Churchill, a factory, had, when you come back, a factory had got to, if you'd worked for them before you went in the forces, they'd got to employ you. So when I came back, I was going to, eventually after a little while I was working for Dad's company, but in the meantime I went back to the Austin, said, can I have my job back? I was working in the works, costs and works office, and he said, well, technically I've got to have you back, but it wouldn't be a very good job, and I suggest you look around and get one somewhere else. So that was the sort of reception I got. And I'd got Iron National. I got a degree in electrical engineering.
Well, you know, when you came back, did you know Birmingham well before you went out?
Yeah.
I mean, what were your impressions of Birmingham when you came back? Because I'm under the impression that Birmingham got absolutely hammered during the war, but it wasn't really very well reported. Were there areas that you saw after the war that you looked at which were maybe unrecognisable from when you knew them before?
There wasn't much difference in Birmingham during the war. Mum and Dad lived in Bourneville, if you know where Bourneville is. That's where they lived. Dad had one of the firm's houses, of course, in Bourneville. They owned 3,000 houses in the Midlands, and 50% of them had no electric. So I had the contract to wire them all. I was doing very well, actually.
And a week to do it.
Yes.
Come on, Eric. No, I just wondered, because when if you worked at Longridge before the war, I know that that was one of the areas that the Germans wanted to attack. So I didn't know if there was damaged areas around it.
No, there was nothing. There was the odd house blown up, you know, but nothing very serious. I think they flattened the BSA, didn't they?
Yeah.
Oh, the centre of Birmingham was really flattened, you know. When I said there wasn't any, I was talking about the suburbs like Kings Norton and Bourneville and all that. They didn't seem to be altered, but the centre of Birmingham was flattened. Oh, well, that was knocked about.
Was it a surprise to you when you saw it? The difference?
Well, I knew it had been bombed badly, so you saw the old trams there, and they'd been blown up. Oh dear, it was a mess.